So this we have explained how the first and the second bifurcation takes place, and it is not difficult to see that as you progress, this part will again become unstable here and here, will become unstable. When that happens, you'll have to look at the fourth iterate, and that will exactly show the same kind of phenomenon. So as the period 2 orbit will become unstable, period 4 orbit become stable, so on and so forth. So that is the reason for the period doubling cascade. And now let us go to 2D maps. A 2D map will look something like this. That means xn plus 1 is a function of xn and yn. Yn plus 1 is also another function of xn and yn. Again, we'll have to do the same exercise, obtaining the equilibrium point, the fixed point, and obtaining the Jacobian matrix. The slope earlier will be now represented by the Jacobian. So whatever we inferred regarding the slope will now be inferred regarding the Jacobian. And then we'll have to talk about the eigenvalues of the Jacobian matrix and stability in terms of the Jacobian matrix, and so on and so forth. So this Jacobian matrix will have two eigenvalues, and there are various possibilities of these two eigenvalues and two eigenvectors. Okay? If the eigenvalues are real, there would be two real eigenvectors. If the eigenvalues are less than one and positive, then if you start from an initial condition here along one eigenvector, then in the next iterate, it will be on the same eigenvector, but its magnitude will be multiplied by the eigenvalue, which is a number less than 1. So it will be a mapping closer to that. So it's a jump like that. In the next iterate, it will jump like that. So it will converge onto the fixed point along that eigenvector. Okay. Similarly, if you take a fixed point here, a initial condition here, it will jump and converge along the eigenvector. If you start from initial condition here, what will happen? It will still converge, because now it can be resolved in two components, one component this way, another component that way, and they will both shrink and it will converge. Okay? So we conclude that if the eigenvalues are both positive and less than 1, then it is a converging behavior, stable. Similarly, if it is positive and bigger than 1, then it will be diverging behavior. Not difficult to understand. If 1 is converging, another diverging, that's also possible. So that if you start from initial condition somewhere here, it will tuck, 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 and it will go to infinity. So it will converge along that and diverge along that. So this is this saddle behavior. If both the eigenvalues are positive, it is called a regular saddle. Again, the whole purpose of this introductory lecture is to prime you about the terms, phrases that I'll be using. Regular saddle would mean that the eigenvalues do not go from the same side and converge. That happens when the eigenvalues are real and positive. And this is a saddle behavior, right? If the eigenvalue is negative, then as you start from initial condition somewhere here, it will be multiplied by a number which is negative. And if the magnitude is bigger than 1, then it will flip to the other side at a distance greater than this distance, right? And that way it will go out. So this situation is called a flip saddle, where the second eigenvalue is smaller than minus 1. So it will be a saddle, but it is a flip. Such fixed points will be called flip saddles. And if there are eigenvalues complex, then depending on the magnitude, not the real part, depending on the magnitude of the eigenvalue, whether it is less than 1 or bigger than 1, it will either be incoming spiral behavior or outgoing spiral behavior. Remember, this is a map, and therefore it is discrete jump of points. So it is actually points that are jumping from one to the other. It's not a continuous movement. It's a map. So this gives you a total view of the different types of behavior that are possible in the close vicinity of the equilibrium point, because you are now talking about the local linearization. Now, bifurcations happen when an equilibrium point or fixed point becomes unstable. It was stable, so a stable behavior pertained, that became unstable. So, if it is a linear system, then a equilibrium point becoming unstable means the system collapses. While in a nonlinear system, an equilibrium point becoming unstable does not immediately imply that the system will collapse. A new different behavior may become stable. And that is the bifurcation. So it is clear that bifurcation is related to instability of a fixed point, and the instability can happen in three possible ways. A, so if the eigenvalue is inside the unit circle, it is stable. If it is outside the unit circle, it is unstable. And a fixed point can, or eigenvalue can go outside from the inside to the outside the unit circle in three possible ways. A, it can go through the negative real line, it can go to the positive real line, or a complex conjugate pair can go. Three possibilities. The first one is the one that results in the period doubling bifurcation. The second one is the one that results in the saddle node bifurcation. And the third one is the one that results in a Neimark-Sacker bifurcation. It's a new term I'm introducing, Neimark-Sacker bifurcation. Now, we'll see what happens then. I probably did not bring the slide for that. So eigenvalues became complex, and from the magnitude that was less than one, it has become a magnitude that is bigger than one. That is what has happened. So initially the behavior would be an incoming spiral, right? And that changes to outgoing spiral. But same logic pertains, I said that all this is related to the local linear behavior and therefore really is valid close to the equilibrium point here. There's no reason to assume that elsewhere it is immediately becoming outgoing spiral. So elsewhere it can still remain incoming spiral. What will happen then? Again, a closed loop will develop. So a closed loop has developed. A closed loop in discrete time. Now, what is a closed loop in discrete time related to? A torus in continuous time. We have seen that. Okay. So, this is the mechanism of creation of a torus or a quasi-periodic orbit in a physical system. So, what happens is, in the discrete time, the eigenvalue become from the magnitude was earlier less than one. Now, it has become bigger than one. That has resulted in the creation of a torus. Whatever tori you have come across, they are all created by that. So let us take the Hinnon map. Hinnon map is given by this. First step, to obtain the fixed points. This is something that I will strongly recommend that you do today in the tutorial by hand, but I'm showing you the results so that you can later check. The fixed points are this. And X star, Y star is X star, which means that the fixed point lies on the 45 degree line, which is a nice thing. This immediately tells us that so long as A is less than this, the fixed point does not exist. And for A bigger than this, there are two fixed points because plus and minus. Right? Good. Now we need to look at each one's stability. So in order to look at the stability, we do the Jacobian matrix and plug in the location of the equilibrium point. Eigenvalues are obtained like this. So at the critical point, A is equal to minus 0.09, the two solutions have the same value. It is this value we are talking about. If you substitute here, this goes to zero, and therefore this is the same value. At that point, the eigenvalue is plus 1. So eigenvalue is plus 1. Huh? So, and as A it becomes greater than 0.09, one fixed point is a saddle, the other is a node, obtained from here. Huh? So it is actually then a saddle node bifurcation. So at minus 0.09, a saddle node bifurcation happens. That creates a node and a saddle. Now, as you change the parameter further, the Jacobian matrix changes, the position of the fixed point changes, Jacobian matrix changes, the eigenvalues change, and at this value, out of these two fixed points, one has eigenvalue less than minus 1. So it becomes unstable. So notice what happens. Initially, there was nothing, no fixed point. At this value, a fixed point was born. That was a saddle node bifurcation. As you change the parameter further, this fixed point actually becomes two fixed points and move away from each other, like this. Okay? And at a specific parameter value, this fixed point becomes unstable, and again, two fixed points are born out of that, a period doubling bifurcation. Right? As you change the parameter, again, this four fixed points become unstable, and again that goes to period doubling. So it goes to a period doubling cascade, finally leading to a chaotic behavior that looks like this. Okay, this is something that we will do in the tutorial today. So its bifurcation diagram is something like this. Here is a saddle node bifurcation we have already seen. Here is a period doubling bifurcation. Here is a period doubling bifurcation. This whole range is chaotic. And so on and so forth. And the Nyman-Sackard bifurcation I just showed, that it is something that creates a closed loop in the discrete time phase space. And the closed loop in the discrete time phase space is related to a torus. Okay. More or less, I have introduced the concepts that I wanted to talk about. I'll stop here and invite questions. You have probably noticed there are some terms. When these terms came, I underscored that. Please remember this is the meaning of the term, because later when we talk, we'll use these terms. So I did not assume that you already know these terms. I had to introduce. Yes, let's give some time to questioning. Do you have any question on this? If not, I'll go to the next.
Sir, yeah. I have actually no question. That Neelima-Sackard bifurcation, when you are just trying to make us understand from the board, this thing make me, I can't comfortable with this thing. So can you please repeat once more this one?
Make you comfortable?
No, make me understand.
Okay.
Maybe I'm very stupid.
Let me try to comfortablify you. What has happened is that when the eigenvalues are complex conjugate, but the magnitude is less than 1, then the behavior is incoming spiral, right? Now, as you change the parameter, the eigenvalues change, and at some point of time, the magnitude of the eigenvalue becomes bigger than 1, right? So we are trying to understand what happens then. The eigenvalues are coming from the Jacobian matrix. And the Jacobian matrix is coming from the local linearization. So all this logic is valid only in the close neighborhood of the equilibrium point. And in a nonlinear system, I cannot talk about the whole space in terms of those Jacobian, right? Jacobian is computed at the equilibrium point, and all I'm talking about the Jacobian is valid at the equilibrium point or neighborhood of the equilibrium point. So when I say that its eigenvalue has become, its magnitude has become greater than 1, and therefore it has developed an outgoing spiral, that conclusion is valid only in the neighborhood. Elsewhere, it need not be true. So elsewhere, it remains incoming spiral, and there, it becomes outgoing spiral. If that happens, it's inevitable that in between, a closed loop will develop, so that anything, any initial condition inside will be thrown outwards towards that, anything outward, outside will be thrown inwards towards that. It's the same mechanism of creation of a limit cycle. Okay. Only difference is that now we are talking discrete time. So it is a limit cycle that is being born in discrete time. Now in discrete time, a limit cycle means effectively a torus in continuous time. So in the differential equation system from which the map was actually derived, it is in that system what is happening is that it is the birth of a torus. So if you, this is what is happening, yeah. You notice that. Good. No. I can tell you that. Actually, I did not explain everything in nonlinear dynamics. I only explained the things that I need in the future lectures. But what is happening is this. This is called the integer crisis. This point you're talking about, right? Yeah. What has happened is this. That I said that at this point, a saddle and a node is born. So the node is here. A saddle is going like this, right? At this point, this fellow has become unstable, but the unstable fixed point continues. So similarly, so here at this point, this orbit, this chaotic orbit, makes contact with the unstable fixed point. When that happens, there is a sudden expansion of the chaotic orbit. Because the, I did not talk about that, unstable manifold of the saddle now becomes part of the attractor. Okay. Suddenly I said things that I did not explain properly. So let me explain. If you have a saddle fixed point, it will have a stable and an unstable directions. This is the eigenvectors, right? But it is actually a nonlinear system whose small neighborhood of the equilibrium point we are looking at. And there we are talking about the eigenvectors. Now, if we generalize, we are talking about the, what is the character of the eigenvector? Character of the eigenvector is that if you start from a point on the eigenvector, it will forever remain on the eigenvector. But the actual system is nonlinear. Elsewhere it's nonlinear. Only in the small neighborhood, it is the linear behavior which is represented by this eigenvector. We ask, is there a line elsewhere with the same property as the stable and unstable eigenvector here? Or can we extend these lines beyond the region where it is the local linearization is valid? Yes, we can, but then it will no longer remain a straight line. Okay? It will have the property that you start from here, it will come and always remain on this. Right? This is called the unstable manifold. Similarly, the stable manifold can be there. So, these are the generalizations on the concept of the eigenvector. This will no longer remain straight lines. This will become curves. But with the same property, that starting from any initial condition on that line, it will forever remain on that line. So, this is the stable manifold. Now, actually, these determine the entire behavior of the system. Extremely important. The reason is this. That if you start from any initial condition, what will happen? You can easily see that it will slowly converge onto the unstable manifold and forever remain there. Right? And therefore, if there is any attractor in the system, that must occur on the unstable manifold of a saddle. Okay. Simply stated, but it's a theorem. Now notice that if you take two points at two sides of a stable manifold, in further iterates, this will go like this and this will go like that. Which means two points in the two sides progressively move away from each other. Why do you need this? You need this if there are two different attractors in a system divided by each with its own basin of attraction. You know, I did not talk about it, but basin of attraction. The set of initial conditions from which it goes to this attractor is the basin of attraction of this one. The set of initial conditions from which it goes to this attractor, they must be divided by some kind of a dividing line or basin boundary. Now, what is the character of the basin boundary? Two points in the two sides must go in two different directions, which is the character of the stable manifold. So, the basin boundaries are always created by stable manifolds of saddle points. These are very, very important characters. So, what has happened is that here, is that that saddle point that was not visible but existing, that makes contact with that chaotic behavior. The moment it does, the whole unstable manifold of the saddle becomes part of the attractor. Therefore, it expands. That is what has happened. Any other question? This is 2D. This is 2D, but this one was 3D. This one was 2D. This one was 3D in continuous time. And this plane is a 2D plane. This section. So Poincaré section is 2D. Therefore, in discrete time, we are still talking in 2D. Any other question? Okay. If not, let me proceed. Considerably more complicated in 3D. Yes. So now we are introducing non-smooth dynamical systems. So far I was talking about the general introduction to nonlinear dynamics, and I had been talking about smooth systems. Smooth means everywhere differentiable. Non-smooth means not everywhere differentiable. Simple. I'll come to that later. So there is a whole class of dynamical systems called switched dynamical systems, where the continuous time evolution is punctuated by some kind of a switching event, discrete switching event. Such systems are very, very common in many areas of science and in engineering. For example, all power electronic circuits are switching systems, systems involving relays, impacting mechanical systems, even walking robots, impacting. Nonlinear circuits like Colpitts oscillator, Chua circuit, and continuous systems controlled by discrete logic, thermostats, on-off valves, everything. So this is a very large class of systems, and this course will mostly be focused on that class. So today, I'll give you a basic introduction of this class of systems. So how do you mathematically describe this class of systems? Earlier, I was talking about x dot is equal to fx and the another parameter rho. That was the status, right? But now, this fx rho can have various different functional forms, depending on whether you are in region R1 or in region R2 or Rn. So the whole space is divided into compartments, and depending on which compartment you are in, it will be given by a different set of differential equations. Okay, I'll give you examples. And if you have compartments, there has to be dividing lines between compartments. These are the switching conditions. These are the n-1 dimensional surfaces defined by this kind of algebraic equations. These are called the switching manifolds. So the schematically, the picture would become something like this, that this is the phase space. Now I'm talking about continuous time phase space, x dot. And in this part, it is one function. In this part, it is another function of x and the parameter rho. And this is the switching manifold. It's schematically drawn. It can be different shapes and sizes, but more or less, I'm always trying to give you a pictorial view of what is happening. So this is one part. For example, if there is a impacting system, which is soft impacting, which means there's a cushioned surface. So it is a simple mass spring damper oscillator. And you give a sinusoidal forcing so that it oscillates. But there's a wall. And the wall is cushioned by a spring. Now what will happen? As you oscillate it, so long as it does not make contact, it will be just a normal harmonic oscillator. But the moment it makes contact, it will push it inwards. And as it pushes it inwards, this will push it back. And therefore, the equations will change. Right? So in the phase space, if this is x coordinate, this x dot coordinate, then from one impacting instant, it will go to like this. And then the moment it makes contact, it will push into the other side. And it will go slightly inwards and come back. But these two lines are governed by different sets of differential equations. Right? So this part of the phase space is given by one set of differential equation. And beyond that, switching manifold, it is given by this set of differential. So here is a picture, physical picture. But in the phase space, the picture is that this part and that part are separated by this switching manifold, which is nothing but this impacting condition. Clear? Now, always it's not necessary that it has to go from one compartment to another. It may be so that it remains in the same compartment, but a switching happens. So, when a particular switching condition is satisfied, it is this, another switching condition is satisfied, the system is this, another third condition is that, it is also possible. For example, there is a electronic circuit called the boost converter. It's a very simple circuit. Those who are not from electronics, still I can easily explain it, because you're all from physics or mathematics anyway. So here there is a voltage that's applied. And if you have a voltage and if the switch is on, then there would be a path, which is voltage and the inductor. Therefore, the current will rise. Current will rise like this. Okay? And as the current reaches a reference value, it is switched off. The control is like this. You don't have to bother about it. Just the logic is this. As the current reaches I reference value, it switches off. When the switch is off, then it is the whole circuit that prevails. And then the current that had already been established, that decays, the current will decay. And if the current decays, the polarity of the current, voltage across the inductor will change. So this will become negative, this will become positive. This was negative, this was positive. So this voltage will add up to this voltage. So here there will be higher voltage that is applied here. And the current will decay. This capacitor will sort of smoothen it out so that ultimately this is the load on which the voltage will be bigger than the input voltage. That's why it's called a boost converter. It boosts the voltage. It's a DC to DC converter that is inside your cell phone. So remember, you are always carrying one such converter. Your laptop has some 30 of them. So, and why, when does it again switch on? There is a free running clock. When the next clock comes, if it is switched off, next clock switches it on. A simple logic. So notice that it does not go from one compartment of the phase space. Phase space is composed of the capacitor voltage and the inductor current. It doesn't go from one part of the phase space to another. It goes, it remains within the same part. It only does not exceed I reference. That's the limit. It does not go beyond that. But whenever a condition is reached, the condition is that it reaches I reference, switching happens. The other, this is a state-dependent switching. And the other one is time-dependent switching, where depending on the time, depending on the clock, it switches on. Okay. Consider the hard impacting system. Hard impacting system is where there's no cushion at the wall. So when it moves, you have applied a sinusoidal forcing GT due to which it's moving, and the moment it makes contact, what happens? It has made contact. Immediately, the velocity reverses, but the position remains the same, right? Instantly. Therefore, along the velocity axis, it jumps from one point to the other, and then again carries on. So it is like this, going like this and jump, going like this and jump. So that will be the behavior here. It is low. No, it's not a slow fast system. No, slow fast system is different. It is not. It's just the impacting system. So here also, it is not going from one compartment to another, but the switching is happening, right? The switching is resulting in the jump of the state itself. So in these systems, what we normally do is, again, to discretize it. Discretize it by means of a Poincaré section. That means you place a Poincaré section and you discretize it to obtain a functional form like this, and this is what you have already seen in the last lecture. In case of a non-autonomous system, yeah. Explain. Yeah, compartment means that in the phase space there are parts. In the phase space there are parts. Say there's a part. In this part there's one functional form, and this is another functional form. So as it goes from here to here, the functional form changes. So the behavior changes. But in these cases, it is not really going from one compartment to the other. Okay, in this case, even the equations are not changing.
Yeah, but the last for the soft impacting system, it was
like, yeah, going from one compartment to another. But in this case, it's not. It is not going from one compartment to the other. Even the equations are not changing. Only state is jumping from one place to the other. Okay, that's also a non-smooth dynamical system. So if you have a non-autonomous system, which means that there is a external periodic input, then the usual way of discretizing it is to observe it in synchronism with the external periodic input. If it is a sinusoidal periodic input, then you might say that I'll observe it every time there is a zero crossing with a positive slope of the sinusoid. So everything, so which means that you are observing it periodically. It's not placing a Poincaré section. Okay. So for a autonomous system and a non-autonomous system, the methods of discretization are different. In an autonomous system, there is no external periodic input. There you place a Poincaré section. In a non-autonomous system, there is external periodic input. There the always the method is to observe it in synchronism with a clock. It is like, have you ever seen a stroboscope? Have you seen a stroboscope that flashes and the frequency of the flash can be changed? We engineers used it all the time because some machine is rotating. What speed is rotating is very difficult to measure. All you need to do is to put a stroboscope and make a chalk mark in that machine. So you flash, and then if your flash is at the same frequency as the rotation, the chalk mark will remain static. Right? So it is very easy to measure a rotation by means of a stroboscope. Stroboscopes are very common things that we use. In discos, this is also very common, I suppose. Huh? Right? Flashes. Now, it is like you're sitting in a darkened room, the phase space, and some orbit is happening, and you're sitting with a stroboscope, which is click, 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 and it's giving flash, and it's illuminating the point at which the state is. This also we have discretizing. So the way of discretizing a non-autonomous system is like that. So it's like this. So the orbit is there, and you are observing at discrete instance. So then we obtain the equilibrium point, the fixed point, and then we obtain the Jacobian matrix. And then again, just to recall, we had already done this, that there are a few different types of fixed points. A regular attractor is when the eigenvalues are real, but between 0 and 1. A regular repeller is between when it's bigger than 1. Regular saddle is when between 0 and 1, but 1 is bigger than 1. Flip saddle is when 1 is negative. Spiral attractor is when the magnitude is less than 1. A spiral repeller is bigger than 1. Right? This is what we already learned, just recapitulation. Now, in a switched dynamical system, suppose we are considering a system that has compartments, then there can be orbit like this. Okay. And it is not yet intersecting the switching manifold. And there can be another orbit like this where it is intersecting a switching manifold coming back. And as I said, that the way to analyze it is most often by placing a Poincaré section. Suppose you place a Poincaré section. Now, there can be one kind of orbit from one point on the Poincaré section to another that does not go through or does not pierce the switching manifold. So it will just go like this. It will be given by one kind of functional form. You may or may not be able to actually write down the functional form, but in your head you can see that there is a functional form. There can be another orbit that goes through the other side, comes back, and comes here. There also, this point will be given by a functional form. The question is, will this functional form be same as this functional form? Definitely not. Follows from common sense. Right? So it will be given by different functional form. Whatever it is different. Right? And the distinction is created by the orbit that just grazes. Slightly above it, it follows this functional form. Slightly below it, it follows another functional form. Right? Which means that the discrete time phase space will look something like this. It is, suppose there are two variables, x1, x2. So there will be a compartment that has one functional form, another compartment with a different functional form separated by a borderline. And what is that borderline? That borderline, for example, here, there will be a borderline such that starting from this side, it will be like that. Starting from this side, it will be like that. So that borderline is the one starting from where it will just graze this switching manifold. Okay. Therefore, this will be the character of the phase space in discrete time. So if you have a switching dynamical system of whatever type, its discrete time representation will have something like this. Now, how do you obtain it? Yeah.
The position of the Poincaré section is very much important, how much I understand.
Yes, it is important.
For a given system, there must be some tool that this is how we have.
No, Poincaré section is always placed at any position with the condition that it must intersect the orbit at every cycle. That's all. if you place the Poincare section with that constraint, then this will always be true. Okay. See, what will happen? Suppose in place of the Poincare section being here, you have made it slightly below. What will happen? The position of the boundary will change. But boundary will be there. Okay. The functional forms might change. But some functional form will be there. And this fact must remain the same, that there will be two parts, there will be two parts with two different functional forms. So if you change the boundary, the functional forms may slightly change. The position of the border may slightly change. But the overall qualitative character of the system remains the same. Clear? Yeah. Any question? Yeah. The borderline is in the discrete time. Whereas here the switching manifold, the switching manifold was in continuous time. Okay. So we are now bringing it down to discrete time. And in doing so, a new borderline is being defined. It is that line starting from where in one side, it will not pass the switching manifold. In the other side, it will pass the switching manifold. That's it. Logical? Okay. So let us see an example of how to actually obtain the map in a physical system. I take the same example of the system that I just described. Now, what is the slope of the current when the switch is on? It is the voltage and the inductor, and therefore the voltage is LdIdt, and therefore the DiDt is the slope, is just voltage by inductance, straight line. If you assume for a moment that this voltage is constant, then the down slope is out voltage minus in voltage divided by L. Simple. Now what happens is that there are two different ways by which it can go from one observation instant to the other. Remember, it's a non-autonomous system, therefore we are observing at every clock. So when we try to obtain the map, it is basically this value mapping to this value, mapping to this value, mapping to this value, so and so forth. We are trying to obtain a functional form. Okay? Just to show, cite an example. So in one case one, it goes to the reference current and then comes down and reaches this point. So when that happens, and notice that if it is below a certain threshold value, then it does not reach the I reference at all. It just keeps on all through. So this point maps to this point. Obviously, this map and this map will be different functional forms. Now we are trying to obtain the functional forms. So if the I at the nth instant is bigger than this critical value, then it will be this. So the on time is I reference minus IN divided by M1. Simple algebra. The off time here is total time minus the on time. And therefore, this value is I reference minus M2, is the downslope, times the time of time. Substitute all that, you get this expression. If it is like this, that is, the value at IN is below this value, then all through the time period of T, from here to here, it remains on, and therefore IN plus 1 is IN plus M1T. Simple. So it's the map is written like this, that if IN is bigger than this value, then the map is this. Smaller than this value, the map is that. The map is therefore written as a if-then-else statement. Okay? And if you draw the graph of the map, it looks like this. All right. So now let me tell you the different types of piecewise smooth maps that you can come across that actually represent different physical systems. And the way we try to understand the character of those physical systems is by analyzing those maps. Okay. Piecewise smooth means, smooth means everywhere differentiable. Piecewise smooth means in two pieces it will be differentiable. For example, like that. In this part, it is everywhere differentiable. In this part, it is everywhere differentiable. But at this point, it's not. Okay? So this is a typical example of a continuous piecewise smooth map. It is continuous at this point. For example, the piecewise smooth map obtained from that boost converter is like that. Piecewise continuous. There are certain situations where the map becomes discontinuous. Discontinuity happens when there exists a line on the Poincaré section such that two points arbitrarily close to that line in the two sides of the line will map to wide apart. Okay. When that happens, then the map becomes discontinuous. And one example is the Colpitts oscillator. Probably anybody who has done electronics course has read about Colpitts oscillator, so I don't need to explain. But it has been shown that its map is like this. So at this point, there is a discontinuity. So we need to understand the behavior of such discontinuous maps also in order to understand the behavior of such system, physical systems. The impact oscillator, especially the hard impact oscillator, it has been shown that that gives rise to a map with a square root term here. Notice the functional form. It is a line. Alpha x plus mu is a line if x is less than 0. And this side, it is beta root x plus mu if bigger than 0. Notice the character. As you go closer and closer to x equal to 0, what happens to the slope? Try to understand this. If the functional form has a square root, what is the slope? Or dfx dx? The square root goes to the denominator, right? The square root goes to the denominator. As x tends to 0, this value goes to infinity, which means the slope goes to infinity. And slope goes to infinity is this, right? And this is called a square root singularity. Square root singularity means it's a slope singularity. Slope goes to infinity. And this is what happens in an impact oscillator. In some of the later lectures, you will see why an impact oscillator gives rise to a square root kind of term in the map. Today, we'll not treat with that. Some of the later lectures will do that. And this gives rise to various issues. For example, it has been observed for some 30 years that whenever there is an impact oscillator, any system that has a possibility of impacts. Impact is where there is a wall and there is something that moves and at some critical amplitude, it just makes contact or hits, right? It has been observed that the critical phase comes when it just grazes. Grazing is zero velocity impact. When it just grazes. At that point, suddenly a very large amplitude chaotic behavior develops. And this has been a reason for much worry. For example, there has been situations where you have all flown by aircraft, right? And these aircraft have turbojet engines, right? And in the turbojet engines, the heaviest thing is the shaft. The heaviest thing is the shaft. And in an aircraft, with good reason, we try to reduce the weight. So the aircraft companies have been trying to reduce the weight of the shaft. That means make it thinner. When it becomes thinner, it has a slight, wobbling motion, that kind of thing. can develop. Now, in order to arrest that wobbling motion, they try to put some kind of a, you know, arrester, so that it does not move too much. They found to their surprise that when you have that arrester, it has a tendency of wholly collapsing. Why? Because as it wobbles, beyond a critical amplitude of the wobble, it will make contact with that, which was not happening earlier, its impact. And at that moment, a very high amplitude chaotic oscillation develops and the whole thing collapses. So the whole project was abandoned. Why does this, that happen? In this way, I can show you hundreds of examples where people tried and people found that suddenly at grazing, a large amplitude chaotic oscillation develops. Now we understand by doing this, all this analysis, that it is because of this square root singularity. The moment it goes, the fixed point goes from here to here, immediately the slope becomes infinity. Infinity slope means it must be chaotic. Can't help it. We'll come to that analysis a little later. There are also certain systems that give rise to functional forms like this. Notice this three half term. The kind of system that gives rise to this is, one of them is the one that I showed earlier, where there's a cushion surface, cushioned with a spring. The character of the spring is that if the impact has not pressed the spring significantly, that means if the pressing is yet negligible, then the force is also negligible, which means that the system equations do not change instantly as the impact happens. They begin to change as it presses it a bit below. So in those systems and in what is known as stick slip motion, he said that he wants to work on stick slip motion, and therefore I wanted to mention it, that it gives rise to a set of equations something like this. Notice that it is smooth. The slopes in this part as x equal to 0 is, slope is alpha, right? Slope is df dx is alpha, and here df dx is alpha plus beta times something. Times whatever is in the in numerator, not in the denominator. And therefore, as x tends to 0, this term goes to 0, and this slope remains the same. So it is actually a smooth system. Actually a smooth system, but if the spring is very hard spring, even though mathematically it's a smooth system, its behavior is almost like a other impact oscillator. And there can also be systems where you have a square root singularity as well as discontinuity. Mathematically possible, we have not yet found a system, physical system, with that character. And where is it? Yeah. In a 2D system, you can also have all these possibilities. I showed it in 1D because you can see the graph. In a 2 dimension, you cannot see the graph, but you can also have a system where this is continuous. So as you go around, the function form changes, but changes continuously without a discontinuity. There can also be systems where there is a discontinuity. There can also be systems where at this point there is square root singularity. There can also be systems where at this the line there is a three half term. All these things are possible in 2D also. All these things are possible in 3D also. So all these are possible, and these represent very many physical systems. So the way we now try to understand these systems is by trying to understand the behavior or the dynamics in this kind of maps. And much of this course will concern that. Professor David Simpson, who will come later part of the course, he will talk in terms of the continuous time systems and what can be understood by studying continuous time systems as continuous time systems, while the others will deal with mostly the discretized systems and what new behaviors that are not visible in a smooth system are observable in a non-smooth system. This will be the content, more or less. Okay. Let me see if there's more. Probably no. Yeah. Now, if there can be a power of 1/2, there can be a power of 1, there can be a power of 3/2, then also possible that there can be a power of any arbitrary value, m. So this also in general possible, and people have studied that also. Now, what is the new thing that can happen in such systems? In a continuous system, in a smooth system, we have seen that as you change a parameter, your eigenvalues can change, and the eigenvalues can exit the unit circle, and when there is an exit, when it exits the unit circle, a bifurcation happens. And we have seen that can happen in three possible ways. Either it can exit the unit circle here, or a complex conjugate, but smoothly, continuously. That is the character of a smooth system. While in a non-smooth system, the eigenvalues can jump discretely from any place to any place. Okay, like this. If they were real and one positive, one negative, and suddenly something happens, they jump from one to the other. So there is a plethora of possibilities then that what can happen in this kind of systems. And then when these kinds of systems are, you know, coupled to each other, synchronized to each other, various many possibilities, more possibilities begin to occur. And in this course, we'll mainly deal with these. Okay. Fine, let us thank and finish and invite questions. We have some more time. If you have any question on whatever I have talked about, yes. Which oscillator? Yeah, actually two cases, this is the borderline case.
You can have another borderline case.
Which?
From where it reaches I max, when it goes down.
Yeah, it from here it reaches I max at the next clock instant.
Yeah, yeah.
This is the borderline. It reaches IMAX before the next clock instant. This is one.
It reaches IMAX just at the instant you are observing.
Yeah.
Then it crosses your another time period. Then the switching happens. So it again moves up.
No. You are always trying to obtain the map from one clock instant to other, not the next. Not the next. So from here to here, what are the possibilities? Either it can go this way, or it can go this way. There is no other possibility. And the critical difference between these two happens when this case, when it reaches I reference exactly at the next clock instant. If it is slightly above, then it goes like this. Slightly below, it goes like that. All right. And in both cases, you can derive the functional forms exactly. So this is a nice copybook case, where you are able to write down the functional form. But remember, in most real physical systems, you might not be able to write down the functional form. Then what happens? See, we said that in a nonlinear dynamical system, you place a point cross section, it becomes a map, like if xn plus 1 is equal to function of xn. What function? Now that function can in some very rare cases be actually written down as a functional form, in closed form. In other cases, what happens is something like this. Suppose you have, and you place a Poincaré section. So you will actually so it starts from here, it goes around and comes back here. It is this functional form that you are trying to obtain. Now that, in most cases, it is not possible to write down in closed form. What do? You write a code that solves the differential equations by say fourth order Runge-Kutta method. Start from this as the initial condition, that chunk of code returns this. So that chunk of code becomes your map. Okay. That chunk of code becomes your map, so that you feed in the initial point on the point cross section, it gives you the next point on the point cross section. That is also a map. Yes, you might not be able to do a differentiation or things like that, but much of it can be done. I'll show you later. You can still infer the stability of the map or stability of the system and things like that. Even if you cannot write down it in closed form. Yeah, yeah. You can still do that. That's what I'll talk about in the next class itself. Yeah.
Is there any Lipschitz conditions that you have to worry about?
We normally assume that these are satisfied. Yeah. Yeah. Because without that, the solution would not exist. And if the solution does not exist, then what do we do? So we deal with systems where these are satisfied. Yes. Yeah. Very good question. Yeah. Very good question. So her question is, what if in a non-autonomous system, you are doing a strobe? That means you're observing at every, in synchronism with the external periodic function. And within that, there are two cycles. What happens? You got the point? In the phase space, when you draw, you will see two loops. But when you observe it in synchronism with the clock, then you see that after having that, it's come back to the same point. Then, from that point of view, it will be a period one. Okay, even if it has gone through two loops there. Because it's a non-autonomous system. That is why, seen from an autonomous point of view or a non-autonomous point of view, the periodicities may appear to be different. But when it is a non-autonomous system, you should always look at it from an non-autonomous point of view, which means in synchronism with the external periodic function. Any other question? Okay. If not, as I said, in the tutorial, we will do two things today. Today's tutorial, we'll have some problem solutions by hand, some problem solutions by the computer. For the problem solutions by the computer, you will need some things to be loaded onto your computers. So for that, we'll take some time during the lunch time. You have to come back and we'll have to put that, those software. So let us do some problem solution now by hand, so that we have more time, because we have time till 12, 20 minutes, let's do some problem solutions by hand, so that we are comfortable. In the last lecture, I had given the set of equations for the predator-prey system, and I said that your task is to prove that there cannot be any stable behavior. It will always oscillate. Okay. And the system equations were x were prey and y were predator. We said x dot is equal to, without a predator, it will grow like AX, and with a predator, it will decay like, and Y dot is equal to, without a prey, it will decay, and with a predator, it will grow. So these were the set of differential equations. If you recall the logic, without a predator, the prey will grow. This itself will lead to exponential growth. Okay. So long as the predator prey number is not too large, it's okay. If it is too large, then you have to do a logistic thing. But let's assume simplicity now. With the predator in, it will decay, and the rate of decay will be proportional to the number of times a tiger sees a deer, and which is aptly represented by, at least in the first approximation, by simple product of x and y. The predator population without the prey decays exponentially, this part. With the prey population, it will have a positive term that will depend on the encounter between the tiger and the deer, and that will be in a first approximation can be represented by a simple product of x and y. This is the model. Now, do whatever I have taught you and prove that the system will always oscillate. That is the observation of field biologists. And you are mathematicians, you have been asked to prove it happens. What will you do first? Obtain the equilibrium points. What will you do second? Locally linearize along the equilibrium points. Okay? And from there, try to infer. Obtain the equilibrium points means put x dot equal to 0, y dot equal to 0. And solve for it. I can see clearly that 0, 0 will be equilibrium point, right? But that's not the only equilibrium point. And E by D? Okay. What is the behavior at this equilibrium point and what is the behavior around this equilibrium point? 0, 0. What does it physically mean? Like most of our Indian forests. No tiger, no deer. Okay, 0, 0. That's not the point. Point is that suppose you start from an initial condition away from that, what will be the behavior of that? Will it go to 0, 0? That's the question. It's a very critical question for Indian forests. Will it go to 0, 0? An minus C. Okay. So the eigenvalues are An minus C, right? Have you all got that? Yeah. What does it mean? It is a saddle. A saddle is unstable equilibrium point. So, if you start from a point, it physically means that if you start from a point close to 0, 0, but not 0, 0, then it will go away from each other at that point, which means that the population will grow. Okay? The population will grow. So, that is an unstable point. Let's talk about this. That is the interesting thing. close to the 0, 0, the number of pre will increase. But let's go to the other equilibrium point and do that. Eigenvalues. Plus minus. Minus CA. Yes, but what? Right? And you'd notice that buying, doing whatever, you cannot put any real part here. Notice? Equations are such that there's no real part. A perfectly imaginary component eigenvalue means what? Oscillatory motion. Therefore, it must be oscillatory. You can't help it. Not only that, this oscillatory motion means with, if you start from here, it will be like this. You start from here, it will be like that. Start from here, it will be like that. Depending on the initial condition, it will be either this means this is the predirection and this is the predated direction. So, number of pre is large, number of predator is close to zero, and then it goes around. Number of predator is large, number of pre is close to zero, so on and so forth. Actually, the axes are here, not here. Because this is not the origin. This is this point. So this always remains positive and they oscillate. And it oscillates because this model always leads to perfectly imaginary eigenvalues. Got it? And then people have tried to improve it by improving these terms. For example, this term is too simplistic. Yeah, it assumes that the number of death of the deer will depend on the chance encounter between deer and tiger. But there are issues like a tiger may see a deer and ignore it. A deer may be seen by a tiger, but deer may go faster, evade the tiger. There may be also possibilities that the tiger is not trained enough because it's still young, may not be able to kill the deer. All these possibilities are there, and these are all modeled by scientists. But after all this modeling, still it remains perfectly imaginary. Therefore, it oscillates. See, in mathematics, we are able to offer this kind of explanations to the real physical problems in the biological world. Okay, so we'll stop now. We'll go for lunch. But remember, after the lunch, we'll first have to load certain things on your laptops before we start the tutorial. So come back a little early so that we can do that. Okay, so... Yeah. It is around that equilibrium point. It can be something else, yes. Close to that equilibrium point, it must be an oscillating behavior. That's it. Okay. All right. So let's stop here now.